we're talking about the conductivity in metals and alloys, what we call conductors and resistors. Which you have already used in physics. can see from here is nothing but drift velocity divided by the electric field. And drift velocity has the units of meter per second, electric field has the units of volt per second, so mobility has the units of meter square per volt per second. So conductivity can be said to be charge density multiplied by the charge multiplied by the mobility of the charge carriers. In this case, they are the free electrons. So in conductors, they are the free electrons which are doing that, and the mobility is defined like this. There are some definitions only. Since we are talking about any cubic centimeter of the order of 20 or 23 electrons which are traveling, or maybe more than that. So I can talk only about the average things, you know, because some are getting accelerated, maybe they get accelerated for a longer time, others getting accelerated for a shorter time, and then colliding. So we can talk about only average things. Similarly, we talk about the mean flow path of an electron, which we say is the mean distance it travels between two successive collisions. And again, it's a mean. One electron may be traveling 10 angstrom before colliding. Another electron may be traveling 20 angstrom before colliding. Some may be traveling a micron. Okay? So there could be different lengths they will be traveling. And we define this as the average distance or the mean distance as the drift velocity multiplied by the mean collision time, the tau. Again, it's statistically we are defining this. So there are three things here: the drift velocity, the mean collision time, and the mean collision distance. More is the mean collision time, more is going to be the mean distance or mean free path of the electron. At 0 Kelvin, in an ideal crystal where there are no impurities and no imperfections present, I'm talking about a very pure material at 0 Kelvin. The mean free path is infinite. There are nothing to interfere, there are no collisions taking place. Because it's a uniform potential at that point and no nucleus is oscillating about its mean position, because it's 0 Kelvin. So potential field is not getting disturbed. And therefore, when we assume the potential field is uniform and it's at 0 level, so electron, once it begins to travel, it keeps traveling. And there's no collision. And there are no impurities, no imperfections, which can also disturb the potential field. Right? Let me just ask, how can an impurity affect the potential field? Let's say there's a solid atom sitting. How it can affect the potential field? Its atomic number is going to be different from the matrix. Number of positive charges of the nucleus and the electrons around it, and what it contributes in the outermost orbit, they are going to be different. And also its size is different. Therefore, the potential field in locally in that region where this solid is sitting will not be disturbed. It will not be seen. So uniform potential field is not there when it is present. And it is the potential field which is going to attract or repel the electron which is traveling, depending upon what is the charge. Okay? So that is how, whether it is attracting slowly, less attraction is there or more attraction is there, it will affect the motion of the electron. That's what we have talked about as a collision. Similarly is the situation with imperfections. Imperfections, like, well, of course, the impurity is itself an imperfection. Well, the dislocations, the grain boundaries, which are there, they are also going to affect the uniformity of the potential field. Because uniform crystalline structure is no more there whenever the imperfection is present. That is, there is a singularity in the uniform or what's called periodic repetition which has started in a perfect crystal. That is not there. So potential field is also disturbed. It is no more uniform. And that is going to change the direction of motion of the electron. And that's what I refer to as a collision when the electron is traveling. So when the mean free path is infinite at 0 Kelvin in a pure substance without imperfections, without any impurities, there will be no collisions and the conductivity will be infinite. But we are talking about the average velocity of an electron. We are talking about that's what we are saying is possible. But we are talking about the average velocity of the free electron. Okay? And they are going to repel each other, means they will maintain a distance between them. They will always maintain a distance between them from that. Because they are the same charges. Is all said solutes, vacancies, etc. These are the point defects. Dislocations, these are the line defects. Green bodies, surface defects. So I have point, line, and surface defects. These are the imperfections. I'm not talking about the volume defects. A blue hole in a material that will also affect. All these act as scattering centers. That means they divert the direction of motion of the electron. That's why I call it scattering. And thereby they decrease the mean free path. And since the mean free path is changed, the conductivity reduces. Mean free path is less, mean collision time is less, mean collision time is less, the conductivity will be less. We recall that nth square tau, the one that we used. So connectivity will come down. Among the imperfections which I have talked about in this course, the dissolved impurities, what are solutes, I'm not talking about the undissolved impurities even, are the most effective, in scattering the electron motion or in increasing the resistivity or decreasing the conductivity of the electron than any other imperfection. They are the most deleterious, most effective in doing so. But that's again an observation. Besides these imperfections or the impurities which we are, causing the motion of the, disturbing the motion of the electron or causing the collision of the electrons, there are elastic waves in the solid, which we refer to as phonons. What are these elastic waves? Positive ion core, leaving aside the electron gas, free electron gas, they are oscillating about their mean position at temperatures greater than 0 Kelvin. What will be the temperature? It's already amplitude will be changing, frequency will be changing initially for low temperatures. But by the time we come to 200 degrees centigrade or 200 Kelvin and at higher temperature, your frequency settles down to about 10 to about 13 per second. So these are the ones which are oscillating about their mean position in random directions with random amplitude. But among themselves they are colliding. And different amplitudes are changing. Energies are changing, right? So these are producing the elastic waves. And this is the random vibration of atoms about their mean position. That we call phonons. Other than the impurities, which are present, they are the phonons. These are not impurities, they are phonons. And when something is oscillating, which is producing the potential when it's traveling, even that itself is getting disturbed, the uniformity of the electric potential available is also going to get disturbed. It will not be seen. That's what the shock waves are doing. If you consider the electron traveling in a potential field and uniform potential field, if the uniformity is lost. When the uniformity is lost, at certain locations there will be more attraction, at certain locations there will be less attraction. So that again is causing the collisions or causing the resistivity to increase. And it is this random nature that destroys the ideal periodicity and interferes with the electron motion. Therefore, the conductivity decreases with increasing temperature, because with increasing temperature, vibrations, frequency, etc. So therefore, with increasing temperature, there is more collision taking place, and therefore less conductivity or more resistivity is produced.
Of conductors, I want to conduct electricity
loss during the transmission. And therefore, what I'm looking for is a low I square R loss. That will come about when the resistance is less. That means the conduction is more or conductivity is more. Resistance and resistivity are related to the geometry of the conductor. Okay, that you know. Secondly, whatever conductor I use, I should be able to fabricate it in the form of a wire or in the form of a strip, whatever I want to use it, or in the form of a bar. Therefore, it should be fabricable and it should be convenient. It should not be very expensive material. That's the cost. And then it should have enough strength. It should not break or it should not sag. So therefore, I want the material which satisfies these conditions to be used as a conductor. We should look at some of the candidate materials for this application. One of the applications of the conductors is a long-distance transmission, like from the powerhouse to the town where the people live. And there we have substations. From substations, it goes transmitted to the residences or the buildings or the institutes. So there it has to go. It's a long-distance transmission lines. We use these days aluminum. Sometimes we are using copper, but the availability of the copper, as the demand of conductors increased and the availability of the copper decreased, small limited quantity on the earth crust. So therefore, we are going on to the aluminum. Though I told you earlier, the conductivity of aluminum is slightly less. That may not be very bad if you consider per unit weight. Per unit volume is probably the case, but in per unit weight, it may not be very bad. And the problem with aluminum as compared to copper, or for that matter, silver and gold, with the three very good conductors, which we talked of, its strength, its elasticity, the modulus of elasticity is also low for this. So, as a result, what happens is, when a long-distance transmission cable, let's say overhead cable I talk of, is placed, there is a sagging of the wire because of its low modulus. Its gravity is acting, so it sags. And therefore, the distance between two poles has to be decreased. So there is a shorter length and the sagging is less. Because after all, you don't want it to come down so low that it's just above your head. Therefore, the distance between two poles has to be decreased. And that means a cost in laying the overhead transmission line. To reduce this cost of laying the overhead transmission line, we have found out another conductor, which is called aluminum conductor steel reinforced. I'll try to change its modulus because modulus of material cannot be changed. But making a composite, you can slightly try to improve upon it. So in the center, there is a steel cable, a steel wire, over which one can have this aluminum coil going over, like this. Okay? So you can make aluminum cable, and in between there is a steel wire, which will improve the modulus. And therefore, sagging will be less and you can increase the distance between poles again. Because making a pole itself is a lot of cost, and that cost is reduced. And also, the distance between two poles is increased, maybe you can cross the river bed. The width of the river you can cross if required. And copper is more expensive. Besides being expensive, severability is less on the earth and therefore we cannot get it.
So doesn't steel interfere in the conductivity of
aluminum? Whatever cross section you need for conducting Radially you can have, but however you can see that here we have two conductors in parallel. So the resistance will be lower than the that of the lower one. Okay? So that's not a problem. This is how I try to improve the modulus and the bit of strength in the conductor. I cannot use some other strengthening mechanism which I have discussed. We'll discuss this later, why I cannot use the other strengthening mechanisms. Because modulus certainly I cannot do by those mechanisms. And secondly, even the strength I would not like to increase by those techniques. The reason is that all those techniques are going to increase the resistivity of the material. Right? Because they are going to increase the imperfections. And all imperfections are going to increase the resistivity. Now, the other application possible for conductors is distribution lines from one in the room to the maybe the switchboard to the room, and from the room maybe to the switch to the bulb, etc. Bus bars, energy conversion applications like fans or motors, things like that, where we are trying to convert electrical energy to mechanical energy. Here, I cannot use aluminum. One reason is melting point is low. Secondly, with small spark, when the heat it gets heated, it gets oxidized for more. Anyway, aluminum always has an oxide layer on top, so very wet material. So therefore, I cannot use aluminum there. We use copper. It's called oxygen-free high conductivity copper. OFHC. Oxygen-free high conductivity copper. But sometimes, still, we need to improve the strength of the copper which we are using. And we do that, if possible, to use cadmium. The solution strengthening is obtained by adding cadmium. A small addition like 0.5% cadmium does not increase the resistivity very much, while it increases the strength a lot. Now, all of the impurities, when added to copper, they decrease the conductivity or increase the resistivity very much. So therefore, I can probably make use of this, and that's what we exploit. You know, an application in manufacturing process that I learned about spot welding. In the spot welding, you have one copper electrode and second copper electrode, and you have the job in the middle which you want to weld. Now this welding is done by putting this in between the two electrodes, and these electrodes are then pressed. Because of this resistance heating here, there is a fusion taking place in the middle here, junction. Because of that heating, some fusion takes place and the wire joining occurs. That temperature rise is also found by these electrodes, and copper becomes soft. Any material will become soft on heating and can deform. And that is what we try to gain by adding this 0.5% cadmium to these electrodes. We increase the strength of the copper, doesn't deform. By applying the pressure, if the copper itself distorts, I may not be able to apply the pressure here. Pressure may not reach there. So that's what is gained by adding 0.5% cadmium to these electrodes. Now there are other applications like electrical contacts, for example switches, very narrow one, brushes, relays. This is just to make contacts. No? Requirement is again very high conductivity. At the same time, I need high thermal conductivity. Why do I need high thermal conductivity? When there is a switch, you switch on and off. If you are able to switch off the lights, you will be able to see there is a spark. having two opposite polarity electrodes are bound together at some distance, there will be spark produced between them. Right? And when they make the contact, the spark will go off. But similarly, when you break, by the time you reach here, there is a spark. When you break it away, the spark goes off. But this bubble has the intermittent formation of spark and the heating of the two surfaces. And that's why I mean heat to be dissipated, otherwise heat will get accumulated there. But clearly, brushes and relays which are on and off, very frequently they're doing so, there will be a lot of heating taking place in the contacts. And the heat must be taken away. And the material which is used should have a high melting point. Otherwise, it's more, whatever the heat generated, this will just melt it or fuse it. And the material should have a good oxidation resistance. Because after all this is happening in the atmosphere. And the atmospheric oxygen, if it can oxidize the surface, the material oxide is absorbed by a bad conductor and there will be no connection taking place. And I think the material we use is copper again. But when the contacts require very delicate and very sensitive places, we are like the spacecraft or the airplane, where the matter of life and death is possible, or the loss of property is possible, we use silver and gold contacts. And silver contacts can be further because it's a lower melting point than the gold and copper. But silver, more expensive, than copper, but cheaper than gold, is used, and we try to increase the strength by adding cadmium oxide as a precipitate. If there is a heating taking place in silver, decomposes before the melting of all the silver. During this decomposition, it absorbs heat. It's an endothermic process. And then the heat is lost. Temperature is reduced, so silver never melts. That's what is done. This is dispersion hardening. Not soluble in the silver. It's a dispersion hardening caused by addition of carbon monoxide. All I think are listed here, these cardiac materials which I just talked about, copper and silver, gold is quite expensive for that matter, but still it is used, and some of the, of course the computers, the chips when you make, you are making contacts there with the help of gold, at the back of the chip. Copper is cheaper, of course, and silver is expensive, preferred for critical contacts, and strength of silver, as I said, is increased with the help of dispersed carbon monoxide, and it absorbs heat while it gets decomposed. Now coming to the resistors, this is another application of the materials in this category which engineers have to put them to. When I'm using something as a resistor, it must have a uniform resistivity. By uniform resistivity, what I mean is, in 1 meter length here, or next meter length here, the resistivity should be the same. It should not be different. And this uniform resistivity requires the structure of the material is metallurgically stable. This microstructure is stable, which is not changing with time. And we are seeing whether some structures do change with time. So it should be in a stable form. The resistance should be stable, that means. And temperature coefficient of resistivity should be small. Temperature coefficient of resistivity. What is the temperature coefficient of resistivity? We define this as temperature coefficient resistivity. We define as this is the temperature coefficient of resistivity. That is rate of change in resistivity or a fractional change in your resistivity per degree rise in temperature. Fractional change. Dv rho by rho has become the fractional change. And we can also write this as, from experimental measurement, dv rho by rho is not possible, so delta rho by rho can be written as alpha delta t. Can measure the change in temperature, corresponding change in resistivity, can measure the resistivity, and this is the temperature coefficient of resistivity, alpha. It says this should be small. What does it mean? When there is a variation in temperature, like the ambient temperature, the room temperature, the change in resistivity is the next possible value. If it is large, the resistivity change will be large. In the, during the year, you know, even in Bali, the room temperature is changing from 4 degrees centigrade to 44 degrees centigrade. And if the alpha is large, there will be large change in the resistivity of the material. So performance of the conductor in winter will be different from that it is in summer. As performance during the noon time will be different from what it is in the evenings. So that's going to happen if alpha is large. Then low thermoelectric potential with respect to copper. Any resistor is connected in a circuit with the help of copper conductors. And with respect to that, its thermoelectric potential should be small. Otherwise, there is additional potential developed or the loss of the energy. Good resistance to atmospheric corrosion. Since we are using these resistors in atmosphere and the ambience, it should not be corroding with time. If it is corroding, then of course, again, the corrosion layer which is produced is an insulating layer and will not be conductive. Some of the candidates for resistors are manganese is the one which is a copper manganese alloy. 87% copper and 13% manganese. Its coefficient of thermal expansion is 20 × -6 per Kelvin as compared to copper which is 4000 × -6 per Kelvin. It is very small. Then the next candidate material is a constantum, 60% copper, 40% nickel. These are the two kind of resistors you have used if you have used in the school physics laboratory. Then there are balanced resistors. These are used to maintain constant current in a circuit. And for these, you must have high alpha. Because if there is an increase in current, there will be I square R loss will be more. More temperature. More temperature means more resistance. More resistance means low current. So current will be stabilizing. So in such applications, I need the material high alpha, and the candidate material there is 71% iron, 29% nickel alloy, which has an alpha value of 4500 × -6 per Kelvin, which is more than that for copper. Then resistors are also used for heating elements. I square R loss, and it R to be high. Since it is going to be heating, we have seen the heaters, they become red hot. The red hot, the melting point is low, it will melt. So high melting point, I said. But I said high resistivity. How high resistivity should I have? This is a problem which cannot be worked out by differentiating and saying that it should be so and so much value I need. Look it carefully. If I use a constant voltage, the power loss is V squared by R. If R is large, it will be less. And the same thing is I square R. If R is large, I square R will be with a constant current. Right? So I cannot have the resistivity as high as it becomes a semiconductor or it becomes a insulator. I still am talking about a conductor which I said are in the range of 10⁻⁹ ohm meter to 10⁻⁹ ohm meter. So they most near about every minus 3 and beta resistivity should be. Okay. So that's one thing which we should be careful with. It should not be oxidation resistance because heating element is going to become burned up and it should not be oxidizing at that temperature. It should have good crimp strength. If the temperature is high, you are working just below the melting point of the material maybe, and then it should not be creeping. If it creeps, it's going to cause problems, and maybe it breaks. Resistance to thermal fatigue, because heater is switched off. During the heating, the wire or the resistor expands. When you switch it off, it cools, it contracts. Heating means it's expanding, cooling. Thereby, there is also the stress developed in the material. That causes the fatigue. And the fatigue is now a thermal fatigue, which is caused by the temperature. To avoid this, I need more elastic modulus. Let's see carefully what I'm talking about. This is the stress and this is the strain. Let's say I have a material with a modulus like this. If I have a material with this modulus, or I have a material with this modulus, I am increasing the temperature because of the thermal expansion. Let's say this is the strain developed in the material. So this material will develop this much stress, while this material will develop only this much stress. This has a low modulus, and that has a high modulus. I need a low elastic modulus. So the stress developing the material is the least. Because fatigue, below a certain level of stress, no fatigue effect can be seen. That's called the endurance limit of the material. Similarly, low thermal expansion. If there is a high thermal expansion, strain developed will be this much. The low thermal expansion, strain developed will be this much. So stress developed will be here. Well, it will be here. So stress development will be more if there is a high thermal expansion. So I want low coefficient thermal expansion. It should not expand very much. Okay? So these are the requirements on the heating elements. And then the carbonate materials which we have. More commonly used in the market is the nickel, which is 80% nickel and 20% chromium alloy. And these can easily be used up to 900 degrees centigrade without problem. Your room heaters, etc. are using, or your hot plates are using normally nickel, because you don't want to go to 900 degrees centigrade. If you have an industrial furnace, you need canthal, you can go up to 1100 degrees centigrade. This is 69% iron, 23% chromium, 6% aluminum and 2% cobalt alloy. And doesn't creep because you can see the large number of elongations are there. And gets a solution strengthening is taking place that way in material. If you want to go to steel high temperature like 40-59 degrees centigrade, silicon carbide is the one. Which below 700 degrees centigrade is a semiconducting material. And then another semiconducting material, molybdenum silicide, is also called super canthal. And it can go to 1679 degrees centigrade easily. Then if you want to 1789 degrees centigrade range, you have to use graphite. And graphite, since it's a very reactive material, about 400 degrees centigrade, it will become carbon monoxide, carbon dioxide. I must use the inert atmosphere. If I want to use graphite as a heating element. Then if I want to go to silver, I can get to like 2500 degrees centigrade maybe. I have to use molybdenum, tantalum, etc. But they have very poor oxidation resistance. They have to be used in vacuum or inert atmosphere. And also, these materials are very expensive. You can use them in small quantity. So small, when you are doing the research, you want to have that kind of a temperature in a small volume. You can use these kind of heating elements. Then tungsten is also used for still high temperature. Well, tungsten filaments are used with thorium dispersed in them to increase the strength. It improves the creep resistance of the material. Incandescent lamps have been using tungsten filaments, which have been dispersed with thorium and increase the creep resistance of tungsten. difference, which I'm going to refer to, is the thermometers. Raising temperature, basically. Making use of these conductors and resistors for measuring temperature. I can measure temperature more accurately. The requirement is temperature coefficient of resistivity should be high. And that's now, I'm just now showing you that. I can measure delta T. So delta T would be high if alpha is high. Accuracy means delta T should be as small as possible. It will be small if alpha is large. Okay? And that's what you can measure, and we use pure metal platinum for this. Its coefficient, temperature coefficient resistivity is pretty high for this. And it can be used, the temperature range in which we use this is low temperature range. Is not used at room temperatures. And graphite is also used for measuring temperature as a thermometer, again at low temperatures. Right? I think I shall end with this. The conductors and resistors, we shall start with the semiconductors in the next class.